the echoing green. The sun does arise and make happy the skies. The merry bells ring to welcome the spring. The skylark and thrush, the birds of the bush, sing louder around to the bell's cheerful sound, while our sport shall be seen on the echoing green. Old John with white hair does laugh away care, sitting under the oak among the old folk. They laugh at our play, and soon they shall all say, such were the joys when we, all girls and boys, in our youth time were seen on the echoing green. Till the little ones weary, no more can be merry, the sun does descend, and all our sports have an end. Round the laps of their mothers, many sisters and brothers, like birds in their nest, are ready for rest, and sport no more seen on the darkening green. Okay, The Echoing Green, very interesting poem. I mean, the title is interesting, isn't it? Why is it an echoing green? I think many times when you read Blake's poems, he invites more questions than answers, and we'll see this again and again. Perhaps it suggests the echoing of the ages, that what he's painting here is a picture of a community that has lived this life again and again. Generations have been born and died on this green, and they've lived in the same sort of happy way. They've lived a form of paradise on earth, and what Blake is doing here is painting a picture of what paradise on earth would look like, in sketching it very quickly in rhythm and rhyme. And I think it's important that, you know, it does have that kind of nursery rhyme quality about it, that innocent quality, because remember, this is called the book, The Songs of Innocence. So he's trying to sketch out for us here, although it looks like a really simple poem, a kind of picture of how society should be and could be. So we have the nature, the sun arising, making happy the skies, that we have a relationship, that people have a relationship with nature, which is a happy one. You know, it isn't a world where nature is destroying things. This is a place which is, you know, kind of pleasant in its climate and rather beautiful. The merry bells ring to welcome the spring. So we have a culture, a human culture, that celebrates the seasons, that is a part, almost part and parcel of this kind of natural, happy world. And throughout the poems, we have the natural world, the skylark and thrush here, the birds of the bush. They're singing louder around. They're joining in with a cheerful sound of the bells, aren't they? So the natural world and the human world are together. They're almost as one, aren't they? And part of this sort of paradise. Again, emphasized, isn't it, by the power and simplicity of the rhymes. Sing louder around to the bells' cheerful sound, while our sport shall be seen on the echoing green. I think it's very important, isn't it, that he's sort of saying our sports, and I think what he means by sports is our activities. I don't think he's literally meaning, you know, that people are just doing running races around this place, although that could be happening. If you were looking down at this society, you'll see people playing games, enjoying their life. Again, emphasised by the power of that rhyme, seen and green. And then in the next verse, he paints a picture of old people being living happily with younger people, doesn't he? And the old people are quite happy. They laugh. Old John with white hair does laugh away care. I mean, he's not worried about dying, is he? He's not worried about his future because he knows he's lived a kind of in a paradise. He is living in a paradise, and he knows that he's sheltered by the oak, isn't he? Sheltered by the natural world again, and he's laughing at our play. That's quite interesting, isn't it? Throughout the poems, you see a shift in perspective. We saw this in The Shepherd too. We see it in many other poems. We seem to have the poet sort of looking down at this world, which we did happened in the first verse, but now it's our, that possessive pronoun, our, is important, isn't it? They're laughing at our play, and soon they all say, such, such were the joys when we all, girls and boys, in our youth time were seen on the echoing green. So what they're seeing with the children playing is a sort of echo of what they did, although it's more powerful than an echo, isn't it? They are seeing, you know, a life of happiness being passed from generation to generation. And I think this is tremendously important, isn't it, that Blake is painting a picture where the important things of human knowledge are embodied in your feelings, aren't they, in your activities, that people are not passing on sort of you know, facts and figures to each other, and that's not the form of education that's going on. They're passing on happiness to each generation, aren't they? And then we have the kind of closing verse, sort of, the little ones weary, no more can be merry, they're tired out, the sun does descend and our sports have an end. They gather round their mothers like birds in their nest. Again, that relationship, that link with the natural world's really important, isn't it? And I think, you know, that's why many people have thought of Blake as a very romantic poet, because the romantics, remember, believed in the very strong link between nature and human culture, that and so we see that there, don't we? The children are gathering around like birds in the nest, that powerful kind of simple simile, and they need, they're ready for rest, they're going to sleep, and then it closes, doesn't it? And no sport no more seen on the darkening green, which is interesting, isn't it, that powerful falling rhythm, darkening. Darkening is actually what we call a dactyl, dum dee dee. It's a falling form of rhythm, and we get a sense of death, don't we? We get a sense of sadness, a sense of closure. But that's not to say that sort of going to sleep is altogether hideous. I think perhaps what Blake's trying to say is that the sort of perfect society would acknowledge things like death, of the closure of the day, would acknowledge darkness. So he's trying to paint a picture here of innocence, which is not an innocence that is ignorant. This isn't an innocence which is, you know, unaware of the difficulties of life, of things like death. It is aware of them and it acknowledges them in a kind of humane and kind of caring way. So we have the mothers there gathering in their children like birds in nests. They're caring for their children. And so I think that, you know, Blake's poem is an ambitious poem, isn't it? In those three verses, he's attempting to paint a picture of firstly a society which is at one with nature, and that it communes with nature. Secondly, a society where we see happiness passed on through the generations. And thirdly, a society that acknowledges that, you know, death and the darker things of life do exist. We have that, and I think that adjective, darkening, is very deliberately used there to suggest that this is not the sort of innocence that we would normally think of as innocence. It's a different, a more powerful and active form of innocence. Good exercise to do with this poem is actually think, what would your perfect society be? Paint a picture of that. Have a creative response to the poem. You know, I think he so powerfully and simply draws that kind of paradise that it's worth thinking about. Well, do you agree? Do you think this is the sort of place that is a place of paradise, or would your world be different? I think that we, in our current culture, perhaps make a lot more of, the creature comforts of life, running water and electricity and warm houses and those sorts of things being kind of vital aspect of our existence, and perhaps less kind of emphasis on the natural world.